Today we will be talking about two things, types and serialization. I will give you a very short introduction to Dart's type system, and I will discuss how serialization works, what it is, and why it's needed. Let's start with serialization first. So serialization is this process of translating data that comes from outside of your application into data structures of your application, which means that when you are developing an application, you're using a programming language. In our case, it's Dart. And this programming language has some data structures, like primitive data structures or list, maps, and any other data structures as well. And when you are fetching some data, like reading data from a file or requesting data over HTTP from a remote server, this data comes to you usually as a string or as a binary. So you need to take this data, this string, this chain of characters, and you need to translate it to a data structure of your programming language. So when we are reading a file, in our case, we are translating a string into Dart's data structures, into lists and maps. The process of translating string into data structures is usually called deserialization or decoding, or sometimes even parsing. Just, you know, you're parsing string and you're getting data structure. And the opposite process is called serialization or encoding or stringifying, for example. In JavaScript, you have two methods for JSON serialization, which is JSON parse for parsing JSON string and JSON stringify. But when you read about serialization, usually people use this term to refer two things at the same time. So serialization can mean deserialization, which is converting a data structure into a string, but it can also mean the inverse of that, so deserialization. Just keep that in mind. Just type JSON serialization and you will probably find the information you need. So let's go back to our code. So in line 19, we are reading this file. And load string gives us a string as a result, which is the content of the file we are reading. And then there is a method called decode. So in Dart, they use the term decode and encode for serialization. So we are getting here the content is a string, and we are decoding this string into a collection. And this collection is a collection of maps. So let me first, can I switch? Yeah, I can. Let me open our file. So as you can see, this is a collection of maps, and each map has two keys, but you can have a map which has three keys or a map which only has one key. This is not enforced. And here you are getting this string, and as a result, you have a list, Dart's list of maps. So the first thing to notice here is that I defined my content as a variable, but I can be more specific. I can provide more intent, and I can say this is a string. As you can see, this may be reverted. If I hover over this variable, Dart is smart enough and it knows that this variable is string, because types in Dart are mandatory, but type annotations are optional. And Dart is able to guess the types. And there is a fancy term for that, which is called type inference. So Dart can infer the types from the usage. It can see how you use the code and can like guess, or infer rather, the type for each variable. But this is not always perfect. So in this case, it knows that content is string, but we can be more specific as well, and you can just type string content. But here, collection is dynamic. So dynamic is this special keyword which signifies that Dart is unable to guess, to infer the type, and it uses dynamic because to denote that fact. So here we say string, and here it's still a collection, but I would like it to be more specific. So I can say collection, and if I save, this should still work. So types allow us to provide some kind of additional information to the reader, because if you are developing a bigger application, or if your own application grows to a certain size, it becomes more and more difficult to keep everything inside your head. And types allow you to help with that. They provide the intention, they provide the sort of guidance and documentation to your code. But it's even more important if you are working with other people. And this way you are saying to others, you are giving them more information about your code, and it's easier for them to understand, easier and faster for them to understand your code. So here we annotated those two variables with string and list, but we can be even more specific. And ideally, I would like to say that this collection only holds a certain type of elements. In our case, these are just messages. So I would like to say that this is a list of messages. So I can do that in Dart. But first, I need to create that that type. In order to do that, I will create a class called message. And I will add two fields, which is subject. So it's exactly the same as in our JSON file. We are explicitly saying what fields each message can have. So here it complains that there is no constructor. So let's use this VS Code feature to fill the gaps for us. So it just adds the constructor, and the message is finished. So now let's go back here and let's click again this smart button here, and let's import. So when I click this, it imports from our project this new class called message. And now, as you can see, it the error disappears. Okay, so now let's go to the point where we are using this message, and here at line 42, I also define message as a variable, but now I can be more specific and I can say this one element of this collection, of this list of messages, is a message. It's always a message, because we are dealing with, at this point, with messages. This list is about messages. And when I save this, it will it won't compile, because this syntax is no longer valid, because before the message was just a map, and we could access any key, which means that we could also access the keys that didn't exist, or we can make a typo. So instead of typing subject, I could just, you know, change some letters, and this kind of errors would not be shown in your editor, because Dart is unable to see if this key exists in the map or not. But once we added this this new type message, we can now say something like message subject, and similar here in the body we can say message body. And now we only can access the fields we defined in our new class. So we, at this point, we have two fields, and we can only access those two fields, which means that this code is safe, in the sense that, first of all, I cannot access something that doesn't exist, it's not defined. And secondly, whenever I try to access something which doesn't exist, let's say I made a typo, in this case, IDE VS Code will notify me that there is an error and I need to correct it. So it will suggest me the proper change based on the fields I have in my new type. This way we can develop our applications in a safer way, we could say. Dart is a statically typed language, which means that the types are being checked before the program executes or before it compiles, contrary to dynamic typing, which happens when program executes and something, there's an error. At this point, the execution engine notifies you about the problem. So in this aspect, Dart is safer, because before you give your program folders to run, you are sure that this kind of errors, type related, no longer exist in your program. This way you eliminate some class of problems, but they are always trade-offs. So some people like types, some other people don't like types, because if you don't have types, if it's a dynamic typing, you have more flexibility. It's a trade-off and you must decide. But if you are starting, and this course is for people who are starting programming, you should definitely use types, and a language like Dart is perfect for that. So right now I save my program, I refresh it, and still it won't compile. So as you can see, it says that there is some problem with our list, and it stops the execution. So this is similar to a breakpoint as we discussed before. Let's focus on this line. In this line, we are getting a string and we are trying to decode it into a Dart's data structure. And at this point, Dart is only able to provide us with a list of maps. We don't want a list of maps, we want a list of messages. And for that reason, we must help out a little bit. We must help Dart to take each of these maps and translate it into a map. So let's resume the execution. So here in message, we have to create another constructor . So this constructor will tell Dart that once you get a JSON, once you get a map that resembles a message, here's the way to translate it into an instance of the message class. And it's very simple. So we are just saying that subject, so this field over here, equals JSON subject. So this is exactly the same thing we were doing when we were displaying our initial list. We are just saying message and we were accessing a field from a map. And here we are saying that take this map, take a key, take a value at subject key and assign it to this field in the message, in an instance of message class. And the same goes for body. So we just say it's a body. And that's pretty much it. And now let's define another variable, messages in this case. And let's take the collection, and I will use a function called map. So it's pretty funny, because in Dart we have a data structure called map and we have a function called map, but these are two different things. So the map function on a collection means that we are taking each element of this collection. So in our case, it's a map, and we are executing a function on this element. So the parameter of the function is the element, the current element we are taking from the collection. So let me write some pseudocode here. So when we have a collection of four elements, a list of four elements, when I say map, and I say, for example, element, and I say element plus one, the result will be 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. So I'm just applying this function. I'm applying this function to each element in the list, and I create a new list out of this. Okay. Here it's the same thing. We are taking each map and we are translating it to an instance of message class. And finally, we just need to convert it to list. And if I hover over to list, as you can see here at the, I wanted to show you the top of this pop-up, it says arrow list message. So Dart is able to infer properly the type, which is pretty cool. So this message is exactly list of messages. So finally here, I no longer need to use collection. I'm using messages. And when I save, I should have my messages reappear. Okay, so I made a small mistake. So if we go back to message, here I wrote map dynamic string, and it should be string. It should be string dynamic, because in our maps, keys are always strings. They can hold any data. So it can be a string, it can be an integer, or it can be a list. So that's the proper way of writing this. And now that's the only change you need to make. And when you refresh, the list reappears and nothing really changed. But in terms of the code, we made it more explicit. So that's pretty much it. To summarize, types are very important to specify your intentions, to be more explicit about your code, to help others if you're working with a team or just other people. It can be one person. Types are very useful for others to understand, as well as for you to help you to recall how your code is structured and what you had in mind when you were writing this. And as the application grows, this becomes more and more important. On top of that, in languages like Dart, where with static typing, types allow you to eliminate a class of problems. So as we've seen here at the line 44, and then at the line 47 and 40 and 53, now I can, once I define a message as a specific type, message class, I can only access the fields I defined. So it's more safe. And I cannot make a mistake, because if I make a mistake, Dart won't compile this code. In short, types are extremely useful. You should use them. And because Dart infers your type, you can start prototyping without using type. You don't need to be bothered by types at the beginning, and gradually you can add them. This is a very nice feature, and not all of the programming languages have that. As your program grows, types also allow you to be more efficient, not only maintaining your code, but also refactoring it. The IDE can inform you once you refactor your code about potential problems, etc. So it's definitely very useful. Let's stop here, and in the next episode, I will show you how to automate the process of serialization. See you there.